Hi, I'm Norman Wildberger. Today we're going to look at how chromogeometry allows us to think about not just one Euler line, but three different Euler lines associated to a triangle. So I remind you first about some things that we've talked about in an earlier series on triangle geometry. If you have an ordinary triangle, A1, A2, A3, in the ordinary blue geometry setting of Euclidean geometry, then the orthocenter, the centroid, and the circumcenter all lie on a single line discovered by Euler, so it's called the Euler line. And the orthocenter, I remind you, is the intersection of the three altitudes of the triangle. The centroid, G, is the intersection of the three medians of the triangle, joining a vertex to the midpoint of the opposite side. And the circumcenter is the intersection of the three perpendicular bisectors, emanating from the midpoints, going perpendicularly to each of the sides. And moreover, Euler discovered that these two segments are in the ratio of 2:1. Now let's have a look at the same phenomena in the green and red geometries. So we'll take the same triangle, simply translated, so that nothing essentially changes. Let's start with the green geometry, which is a little bit easier because the notion of perpendicularity is a little bit simpler. So let's look at the intersection of the altitudes. What's an altitude? Say the altitude from this point perpendicular to this side. Well, in green geometry, a line perpendicular to this side is obtained by reflecting this line in the coordinate axes, in either of the coordinate axes. So here's a coordinate axis. We reflect this line, we get a line like this. So this line here is perpendicular to this one here. And the line through A1 in that perpendicular direction would be this. So that's one of the altitudes. The altitude through A2 has to be perpendicular to this. Perpendicular to this means we have to reflect in the coordinate axes, say the vertical one. And so that's the altitude through A2. The altitude through A3, it's going to be perpendicular to this one. So that's in that direction there. And so that's going to be the third altitude. And lo and behold, they all intersect in a single point, the green orthocenter. So that's a theorem that for any triangle, the three altitudes in the green sense intersect. The centroid, G, that we're going to take is the same centroid as before. That's an affine notion and doesn't depend on our choice of quadrants. What about the circumcenter? Well, for that we need perpendicular bisectors. So for example, the perpendicular bisector through this midpoint goes through there and is on a line perpendicular to it. So there's the perpendicular bisector. The perpendicular bisector at this point is that one there. And the perpendicular bisector through this point has to be in that direction. And the three perpendicular bisectors meet at that point C. And we now see that the orthocenter, the centroid, and the circumcenter, in the green sense, are all collinear. That's a new line, the green Euler line. And moreover, it turns out that the ratio of this to this is still in the ratio of 2:1, just as it was in the blue setting. In the red setting, it's much the same, so we're going to take that same triangle and see what it looks like in the red situation. The only difference now is that perpendicularity amounts to reflecting in one of these red null lines. So the perpendicular of that would be that. All right, so let's have a look at some altitudes. The altitude through A1, it's got to be perpendicular to this. Well, perpendicular to this is like that. So there's the altitude. That's the first altitude. The altitude through A2, well, it's got to be perpendicular to this. And that's almost a null line itself, so its perpendicular will be essentially itself. And so the altitude is this one here. Notice that in that case, this altitude doesn't even necessarily have to meet that opposite side. It's an interesting phenomenon. And finally, the altitude through this point, perpendicular to this one. Well, if we reflect that one there, then we get perhaps something like this. And that altitude there, the three altitudes meet at the red orthocenter right there. Our centroid G is as formerly, and now the intersection of the perpendicular bisectors, you can check it's the same kind of story, is that point C there. And yes, they all lie on a new line called the red Euler line, and moreover, OG to GC is still in the ratio of 2:1. So this shows us that the familiar phenomena in the blue geometry extends to the green and the red geometries. So the three geometries are acting in a similar way, even though the actual pictures are quite different. So that's our first basic principle of chromogeometry, that there's some kind of parallel between these three geometries. Now the second principle is that these three geometries fit together. And that means if we look at all three of these constructions at the same time, we should find something new and interesting. And that's exactly what happens. So now I've taken a triangle A1, A2, A3, very similar to the one that we've just been looking at. And here is the blue Euler line with the blue orthocenter, the blue circumcenter. And here is the green Euler line with the green orthocenter and the green circumcenter, and the red Euler line with the red orthocenter and the red circumcenter. So now we're looking at all three pictures at the same time, on the same picture, and we see that something really remarkable happens. These three geometries interact. In what sense? Well, you can see that, well, first of all, the three Euler lines go through the centroid, but that's the way we constructed it, so that's not too surprising. But what is surprising is that the triangle formed by the three orthocenters, that triangle has on it the three circumcenters. And moreover, it turns out that these three circumcenters are actually, in fact, the midpoints of the sides of this triangle of orthocenters. So this equals this, this equals this, and this equals this. And note that there's a pleasant symmetry. The red circumcenter is between the green and the blue orthocenters, and so on for the other colors. So we're going to call this triangle formed by the three orthocenters, the omega triangle of the original triangle. So now given any original triangle in the Cartesian plane, there are the coordinate axes, there is now an omega triangle, which contains the three Euler lines as its medians. These are now the medians of this omega triangle. And now the fact that we have this ratio of 2 to 1 is not surprising at all, because it's simply a manifestation of the fact that the medians split each other always in the ratio of 2 to 1 in any triangle. So next time we're going to have a better look at this omega triangle and note that there's more to say about it, and that in fact there's quite a lot of interesting aspects to it. I hope you'll join me for that. I'm Norman Wildberger. Thanks for listening.